We should be clear about what a play is. What is a natak? Usually we associate plays with dialogues. But you must remember, since you're all, I think, aspiring to be writers of different kind, that a dialogue is not a conversation. There's a big difference. When you go in a train, you hear two people talking. You hear, it's interesting, they're talking, they're fighting, or they're, you know, proposing, or whatever it is, and then they get down and go, and you forget it. You know, there is just a conversation between an exchange of ideas between two people, but it doesn't give you an idea of where they came from, where they're going, and you are not interested, you are on your own way somewhere else. Now, the point about dialogue is that the audience has come there to listen to dialogues being exchanged by the actors, so the dialogue has to tell the audience, who are these people? The first thing a dialogue has to create is the characters. If it's A and B, what is A, what is B, where does A come from, where does B come from? And because of this, a play essentially has, although what happens in a play is what happens in front of you, has a past and a future. And each character brings a past and a future. And a good playwright should be able to, with each sentence, express, bring out this past and the future about it. Then what does a dialogue do? This is the second point. What are these characters trying to do? Of course, they're trying to tell a story. Everyone is interested in a story. But what is actually happening there in any play, in any good play, is one character is trying to persuade the other character to do something. You know, there has to be action. People say that there has to be action in a play. But an action doesn't mean that they have to run around on stage, beat each other, this. The action is in the dialogue. And the action in the dialogue says that one character should try to persuade the other character. It may be Manthara trying to persuade Kaikeyi that her son should become a king. It may be someone trying to seduce another person. It may be Lady Macbeth trying to tell Macbeth, kill the king. You know, and all these are sort of major, well-known cases of persuasion, but even in smaller things, in little suggestions, little gestures, the whole process of persuasion goes on between two characters. Then there is a third, second degree of persuasion which happens, which is that this dialogue must persuade the audience that it's worth listening to. Otherwise, the audience will get bored. So, you know, there are two kinds of levels of activities going on. The two actors or actresses are trying to persuade each other, resisting the persuasion. So that is a conflict there. That conflict arises because the other person may or may not agree to what persuasion is going on. But even more important is that these two or three characters on stage are trying to persuade the audience that this scene is worth listening to, the play is worth listening to, and this is important. So you see, that is a basic notion that every playwright has to bear in mind. Then there are other limitations, which are typically theater limitations. A novel can go on forever. I mean, as you know, War and Peace is something 2,500 years, 2,500 pages. But a play can't go on forever. There was a time when people used to sit through the night to see plays, but then they were allowed to sleep. They had a great advantage, which we don't have these days. So today you have to have a play which at the moment, at the most, can go on for 2.5 hours at the moment. You see, because ultimately what decides the length of a play is the capacity of our bottom muscles. After 2.5 hours, the audience just wants to go home to their activity. And this physical thing doesn't happen in a novel or in a poem or in anything else. You can read it tomorrow. You can do here, it is one continuous activity. So you have this limitation that a play has to be about 2 hours long. Second limitation is that a play can be seen only, say, ideally like an audience of this kind. Say about 550 people. It has been decided that after 550 people or 600 people, if the last man cannot see the facial expression of the actors, in which case a lot of the charm of the theater is gone. Because ultimately, people have to be able to see what's going on stage, and this limited to 400. So what the play has to do is to keep the concentration of 500 people, 500 different people. They may be children, they may be women, they may be adults, whatever it is. This concentration of everyone to listen to what to what's happening, this is essential. It's not like a play. It's not like a poem where you write a poem to one person and the person may like it or reject it or whatever it is. And the third point, therefore, if this is to attract everyone else, is everyone must be interested in what is the play about. A play has a story, of course, and the story keeps you engaged. But ultimately, the point comes, why have I paid this money? Why am I sitting here? Why, you know, why am I going through these agonies? None of these demands are made by a novel, because you can read them at home. None of these demands are made by a poem. But this is very unique about theater. G.A. Kulkarni, the Marathi Kadambarikar, he was in Dharwad and he was a friend of Ashok Kulkarni. And Ashok Kulkarni once told me, G.A. Kulkarni said to him, Natka Girish Karnad natak kase lita tho, phar paravalambi kala hai boha. It's paravalambi because I write my plays, it is done by the directors, it's done by 20 actors, the actors have to persuade. The director has to persuade the actors that this is how it's to be done, and the actors, in turn, have to persuade the audience that it's worth watching. So there are degrees of persuasion to that are worth watching. That need to give the play a focus. And one thing in a play, which you must bear in mind, you can never refer back. You cannot. No, you won't get an answer because you can't stop the play. The play goes on. It goes on continuously. So the playwright has to be very clear that whatever he's explaining in terms of narrative is clear to everyone at every moment. That the whole meaning, structure of meanings is very clear. You see, for a moment, let me tell you that writing a play is really like building a house. You know, I built my house in Madras, and I built it by, my wife was going for a walk with her daughter. She saw a beautiful tree. Hey, this is not Madras, Bangalore. This was in the days when plots were easily available. And that tree was beautifully spreading out like that. And my daughter said to my wife, oh, you know, we could have a terrace under those branches. And my wife said, yes. So she said to me, let's build a house here, buy the plot. We built the house, the branches spread out. We built a terrace under the branch where we could have a party. As soon as the terrace was built, there was a space underneath of the same size. So that naturally made the dining room. So the next dining room happened. Now, if the party is going to be upstairs on terrace or in the dining room, you need a kitchen next to it. You see, the kitchen is automatically there. The staircase goes. But if kitchen is there, you can't have a bathroom next to it. So the bathroom goes a little further down. And from the dining room, you have a living room. So what I'm saying is that there is a step-by-step evolution in architecture of how you build a house. Where do you want the bathroom? Where do you want the mahdi? Where do you want the main door? Where do you want the back door? Where do you want the postman to come? All these decide the structure of the house. And it's the same with a play, or has to. I mean, many people may say it's not necessary, they write as they like, but this is how I like to write. It's almost like a mathematical puzzle. Now, I mentioned one thing. You see, simply things happening on stage don't affect the audience. They must affect someone. Some character must be affected. But the point is, at each point, you have to motivate. You see, human beings, whether they act with motivation or not is up to them. Sometimes one feels there is motiveless cruelty, motiveless passion, etc. But in a play, you've got to motivate. As I said, a play has to be like a well-built house or a building where every corner has a beam, a solid beam, or a door or a window. Why? You have to go on asking. And this is very important in India, because when some of my plays were done in America, I hope you don't mind mentioning it, you act with American actors. The American actors are continually, they're all college actors, you know, they're continually asking, why should I say this? No, I won't say this. Some feminist girl will say, no, I won't say this. That's an anti-feminist dialogue. So you say, but it's in the play. No, but I won't say it, et cetera, et cetera. They keep questioning. In India, actors rarely question. You give them the play, they do it. You know, and they try to make the most of it. So we don't train our actors to question, to say why this and why that. And that burden has to be borne both by the actors as well as by the playwrights. And this is a responsibility that the playwright has to bear of saying, why do you do this, and so on. Now, I have given you a kind of structure of my play, Yeyati. That's not the only structure. This is a narrative structure, a simple structure. But any great play that you read, you'll find very carefully structured. Before I end my lecture now, I'll give you one example, and that is Shakespeare's Hamlet. You know Hamlet, and simple story. And then slowly you realize, what is Hamlet's story? Hamlet goes abroad to the university. He hears that his father has been killed, his mother has been molested. He comes back, and he finds that his uncle is probably responsible. And then, in the end, Hamlet finds a duel with Laertes, you know, who's the brother of Ophelia. And what is Laertes' story? Laertes goes to a university. He hears that his father has been killed, that his sister has become gone mad. He comes back, and he finds that Hamlet's uncle may or may not be responsible. And ultimately, he thinks Hamlet is responsible. So the final duel in Hamlet is, on one side, there's Hamlet. And on one side, there's Laertes. And both the stories are the same. You know, it's the same story Shakespeare repeats twice. On the side of Hamlet, Hamlet becomes a major tragic figure. Laertes remains a small figure. But at the climax, there are two people, a person, both of them had gone abroad, heard that their father was killed, heard that their sister or mother was molested, have come back, and now are facing each other. So it's like a syllogism, a mathematical thing where the same equation is facing each other in this. And it's not an accident. This is not reading too much. If you see Lear, for instance, you get in King Lear. King Lear trusts his two sons, three daughters. Two he does trust, and third the wrong one he mistrusts. As a result, what happens is King Lear goes mad and wanders on the moors. And as he was wandering on the moor, he meets Gloucester, the Duke of Gloucester. And what's happened to Gloucester? Gloucester is Andhrae. His eyes have been removed by his son, whom he trusted. That is, it's again the same story. King Lear trusted the wrong child and suffers. Gloucester trusted the wrong child, has become blind. And on the moor is a madman and a blind man, both of them with the same background story. Now, this is not an accident. You see, this is, you may say that Shakespeare is a genius and, you know, all this came out flowing. That may be so, you know, but structures don't come naturally. You have to work for them. When Bhimsen Joshi sings a very intricate alap, it isn't just inspiration. There are hours and hours and hours of riyaz that has gone into it. It's created it. And a playwright also needs to do it, to read other plays, analyze them. When you write, question them, and so on. And then you see in the greatest of plays, there's always a structure. A simple example is Shakuntal. I'm mentioning Shakuntal just to say it's not only in the Western plays that you find structure. Shakuntala is a very finely textured play, but Shakuntala, the first act of Shakuntala is in the ashram of Kanava, and there are no marital relationships. You know, Shakuntala's mother was not married. She was an apsara. She left her there, and Shakuntala's all her friends and relations are all dear and dear children, and you know, Dasi, Vagari, Anuradha. And Kanava is not her father. She is an orphan in a pseudo family. That's how Shakuntala, the play begins, and it ends. where Dushyant and Shakuntala meet in an ashram of a family man. You know, where everyone is connected, and Dushyant meets his wife and meets his son, and all the relationships are established. So very clearly, there's a movement in Shakuntala from the first act, where all relationships are nebulous, to the last act, where they are all brought together. And this is not an accident, but ultimately, and this is the final point I want to make, whether a play works or not, apart from structuring and so on, it has to have genuine truth of experience. You know, fake emotions always show. On a stage, this is where great plays and minor plays differ. Whether they convince you, they may bring tears in your eyes, they may bring laughter to your eyes, but do they convince you by their truthfulness?